tonight's lecture. As part of the International Studies Fall 2016 lecture series entitled The Power of Place, Globalization, and Local Identities. The lecture series is funded in part by the New Mexico Humanities Council, the National Endowment for the Humanities, the University of New Mexico College of Arts and Sciences, Departments of English, Geography, History, and Philosophy, the Religious Studies Program, School of Architecture and Planning, School of Law, Geospatial and Population Studies Center, Center for the Southwest, Center for English Language and American Culture. And we invite you here every Monday evening for the rest of the semester, 5:30 to 6:45, for these lectures. And if you've missed any of the lectures in the past, including the past years, you may access them at isi.unm.edu. Next week's lecture, we will have a lecture entitled Where You Find Their Earth by Dr. Beverly Singer, Associate Professor Emeriti and Director of the Alfonso Ortiz Center for Intercultural Studies, Department of Anthropology here at UNM. And so tonight's lecture, I'm really, really excited because it's the first time I will be hearing about this work on by Dr. Eleni Bastea, who is the Director of International Studies, and she is also the Regents Professor for Architectural History here at UNM. She's really the foundation of this lecture series, but also the one behind what's taking place right now with International Studies as a program, but also as an institute. And we are honored to have with us today as commentator and who will introduce Dr. Bastea, Professor of Law Jennifer Moore, a recipient of the Ron and Susan Friedman Faculty Excellence Award. So prior to joining UNM law faculty in 1995, Jennifer Moore worked for the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, first as an Associate Protection Officer in West Africa, then as a legal officer in Washington, D.C. She co-authored the first law school casebook on refugee law and policy. She also authored Humanitarian Law in Action Within Africa, building on her field research in Uganda, Burundi, and Sierra Leone. This was published by Oxford University in 2012. She is currently working on a second manuscript with a working title, Transformation After Violence, Justice, Gender, and Civil Society in Africa. This book focuses on the perspectives of women engaged in grassroots peace-building activities in Uganda, Sierra Leone, and Burundi. So please join us in welcoming Jennifer Moore, who will be introducing Dr. Bastea.
Well, good evening, everyone. I'm Jenny Moore, and it really is a great pleasure to introduce today's lecturer, Dr. Eleni Bastea, our UNM Regents Professor of Architecture, an art historian and an architecture historian who's also director of our National Studies Institute. You know, all of you know Dr. Bastea. You may know that she is the author of The Creation of Modern Athens, Planning the Myth, a book of poetry, Venice Without Gondolas, and she has edited a volume on called Memory and Architecture. But what you may not know about her is what she is to a colleague in another discipline, the discipline of law. Dr. Bastea is passionate about many things. She's passionate about interdisciplinary conversations. She's passionate about complicated problems and challenging global issues. And she's also passionate about creative problem solving. And I think it's in the nature of artists and architects to look at problems in terms of deconstruction and reconstruction. And so it really is a pleasure for me to hear her speak within her discipline and to draw from it in terms of my discipline of human rights. This lecture series, looking at the power of place and conversations about place, space, dislocation, and relocation is something that Dr. Bastea also understands in terms of her own journey Having been growing up in Salonika, Greece, coming to Bryn Mawr College on the east coast of the United States, getting her PhD in architectural history at Berkeley on the west coast, and then teaching in different institutions, including Washington University in St. Louis, and then coming to our own UNM in 2001, she knows something about journeys, and in particular, cross-cultural journeys. But her talk today, which is entitled Geographies of Loss, is focusing more on those who make cross-cultural journeys, not so much because of choice, but also to escape repression, violence, and danger. And so her remarks today, exploring the power of place and the loss of homeland in the narratives of identity and in the narratives and identities of immigrants and refugees, is particularly compelling as we look at global issues today. So we look forward to your talk, Dr.
The city will follow you. You will be returning to the same streets. And in the same neighborhoods, you will be growing old. Inside the same houses, you will be turning white-haired. Always in the same city, you will be arriving. That is part of Cavafis' poem, The City. So I will be talking today about buildings and memories in the city of Thessaloniki, which I don't have a pointer to show you, but it's right here. Okay, and also in the city of Smyrna or Izmir, which is right here, and then a little bit also about Istanbul, right there. Okay, now we're all experts. Let's go. Right. I grew up in this apartment in Thessaloniki, Greece, across from a mosque. At the time, we just called it the mosque. Much, much later, I learned that it was called Al-Aqsa Imaret. Its shadow follows me forever, just as the poet Konstantin Cavafy warned us over 100 years ago. Your city will follow you. When I see the mosque, either when visiting or more frequently in photographs, I think of it not so much as the cultural and exhibit center that it is now, but rather as the Boy Scout center it was when I was growing up in the 60s and 70s. Now, as an urban historian, I can describe and analyze how it's incorporated into the fabric of the modern city, suffocating by the relentless post-World War II buildings. So the mosque that you saw is right here. And most of these apartment buildings date from the 60s and 70s. And so it goes. I think I got it right. And how this mosque, which dates from 1484, has not been used as a mosque for about a century now, this being one of several major monuments marking the city's historical center. Among them, we also see the Roman Forum, which we have here. And we also have the early Christian church of Agios Dimitrios right here. There is an Ottoman bath that had become a movie theater when I was growing up. And then the mosque that I started with is right up there. So you can see the layers of the city, a city that started from the Hellenistic period. And you can see that on its remaining structures. Now, what I want to admit, and what I'm going to admit in front of all of you, is that it's hard for me to imagine the mosque, or it has been hard for me to imagine the mosque as it was originally used. That is, within a neighborhood of Muslims coming to pray regularly, the men taking off their shoes, washing their feet, and going in quietly, the women perhaps gathering outside. My own personal memories obscure the memories of others and of the mosque's past. My not being able to imagine the mosque in its original state is not only a personal failure. It's also the outcome of historical changes, of the development of the nation state that emphasize homogeneity and common heritage, often removing and destroying the physical remnants of other cultures from our mental map and also from the city's physical geography. So here we're looking at a map of Thessaloniki or Salonika from the early 20th century, and you can see that it was made up of three major groups, Christians and Jews and Muslims. Over a century ago, Thessaloniki was part of the Ottoman Empire, and it was a multi-ethnic city. There were also Levantines, Western Europeans, Italian merchants, and so on. It was a city with dense and irregular streets, clearly defined urban clusters, and introverted neighborhoods. It had a population of about 160,000. So of those people, about 40% were Jews, about 30% were Muslims, and about 23% were Orthodox Christians. So the Orthodox Christians were in the minority. Now, looking at one of the wealthier mansions from about 1912, we see that the different civic and religious neighborhoods reflected the population that lived there. And the city was one of the major centers of the Ottoman Empire, as it had been of the Byzantine Empire, its harbor being a central node of commerce and exchange. So this is a city with 40% Jews, 30% Muslims, and 23% Orthodox Christian Greeks. In 1912, the Greek army succeeded in capturing Thessaloniki and the surrounding regions from the Ottomans, incorporating it into the Greek state, so extending the Greek state north. Other changes that happened to the city was a major fire in 1917, which destroyed about 316 acres of the city, dealing a major blow, actually, to the Jewish community, their businesses and residential quarters. Now, fires were not uncommon in the 19th century, and oftentimes they served as a cause for renewal and modernization, and that's also what happened in Thessaloniki, perhaps with the excuse of the fire. The state assigned a team of planners headed by the French architect Ernest Ebrard, which replanned the city. And so on the left, we have the original Byzantine-Ottoman plan of the city. And then on the right, the much more regular layout that Ebrard and his team proposed. The inward-focused character of the late Ottoman city gave place to a modern, open arrangement that introduced the apartment block, the use of reinforced concrete, and the freehold land system, which meant that you could own property horizontally. You did not have to own also the land on where it was sitting. Moving forward, between 1912 and 22, the Greek army led an expansionist and eventually disastrous for the Greeks campaign in Asia Minor, and the aim was to incorporate the city of Smyrna, modern-day Izmir, and its surrounding areas into the Greek state. After the defeat of the Greek army, Greece and Turkey signed the Treaty of Lausanne in 1923, which stipulated the compulsory exchange of minority populations between the two countries. So between 1920 and 1928, now this is also the time of the Balkan Wars, a lot of movement and dislocation, not only among the Christian Orthodox people, but among the Muslims from other Balkan regions and so on. But I'm staying focused on this particular part of the world. Between 1920 and 28, more than 1.2 million Christian Greeks from Asia Minor, Asia Minor being Western Turkey today, all right, this whole area. So 1.2 million Christian Greeks from Asia Minor migrated to Greece, and almost 400 Muslim Turks from Greece migrated to Turkey. So when these people came to Greece, Greece only had a population of 5 million. So it increased and had to accommodate a huge number of refugees. Now, of this large number, 4 Thessaloniki, almost 120,000 refugees came and settled or were settled in Thessaloniki. Now, when I was growing up, we had some sense of the refugee houses where these people were housed. And this is an old photograph. Later on, they were turned down and rebuilt with bigger places. But what was not part of our history lessons in school, and really much of the awareness of the population in general, is that there was also this considerable number of Muslims, about 25,000, who had lived in Thessaloniki and were forced to move to Turkey, a place that was unfamiliar to them. So there was also then this population of the Turkish quarters that was forcibly removed. Exchanged is the euphemism that has been used for that. Ethnic cleansing, you can say, also. And there was life in Thessaloniki's upper town, where most of the Muslims lived, that also dissolved with the forced exchange of population that was signed by both countries. So I think that's important to remember. So houses that used to belong to Muslim families now housed Christian families in many cases, and gradually came to be considered as part of the Greek vernacular architecture. The city's 4 centuries of Ottoman history were silenced, erased, and often destroyed. Its urban fabric was modernized, while its cultural production shifted to highlight the new Greek era. 2 generations later, Thessaloniki's multi-ethnic past becomes almost forgotten, the buildings but empty shells to be filled with new meanings. In the last 40 years, the city increased its population and density, going from 500,000 in 1971 to almost 1 million in 2011. And now, a younger generation and generation of immigrants from the former Eastern Bloc, and more recently from the Middle East that has been set on fire again, gathers under the portico of the mosque, in the parks and elsewhere, playing instruments they brought from home. For Greek writers, the demolition of traditional buildings often became a metaphor for the destruction of traditional neighborhood ties, as expressed in the following prose poem by the Thessaloniki poet Dinos Christianopoulos. He was born in 1931, and this poem dates from 1986. It's called The Death of the Neighborhood. Quote, "At night, the son of the neighborhood woman who lived across from me was waiting for me at the door. Tonight, my mother passed away, he told me, his eyes filled with tears. For a while, we both remained silent. At that point, there were no appropriate words. I thought of letting our neighbors know of the funeral, but aside from Mrs. Despina and you, no one else of the old-timers is left. My mother, who saw all her neighbors off, will now pass on alone. Our neighborhood, too, died with her, I thought, feeling a tightness in my heart," unquote. So this was Dinos Christianopoulos. Writers registered the loss, but mainly when it happened within their own lifetime and to their own family and immediate community. History, too, seems to be framed by our own existence, going back at most to our grandparents' lifetime. And so here I brought for you to see my mother and her sister with their fiancés at the time, as my mother and my father and my Aunt Veta and her fiancé. We mourned the loss of that garden and that house, but I think we were in the same context as only mourning what we lost, not what other populations lost more tragically. Okay, and here is my parents, my grandmother, myself, and my brother in our apartment. I'm using autoethnography, saying we moved from a house to an apartment, like most Greeks of my generation in the 60s, 70s, and so it goes. When I was in high school, and there were still some old houses left in Upper Town, my cultured classmates and I would walk around photographing them. We used slides. We believed that such excursions strengthened the bond between ourselves and our city's historical past, that they elevated us culturally and morally, because, of course, we cared about our city and its past. It was much later, that I began to understand that we did not at all see the houses of the city's historical past, but rather the houses of our very own present. These houses being but a backdrop to our own contemporary adolescent concerns and preoccupations, unfolding against the stage set of the Upper Town. It was like we were scouting for locations to set our lives in front. We were recording the old houses and the old women living there, thinking more like amateur anthropologists, I guess, recording the present taking place in historic shells, rather than as historians attempting to imagine earlier residents. It actually took me, I think I was in my 30s, when I realized the place where I grew up across from a mosque was obviously owned by Muslim families before this exchange of populations. Who else would have been living across from a mosque in the early 20th century? We did not register in detail either the remnants of a more recent past that was not present anymore when I was growing up, but which was still discussed, and that was the extensive Jewish community of Thessaloniki, over 60,000 strong, on the eve of the Second World War. Now, most people living in Salonika would have had exchanges. My father was at school with Jewish men and women in high school. My aunt lived next door to Madame Fernandez and would go and light the stove for her on Saturday when she wasn't supposed to light it herself. So there were those stories, but for me anyway, they didn't translate into what that meant for the built environment that we walked up and down. I wasn't registering the fact that there were also classrooms of kids and so on who were part of the city of my parents, and who had perished. Between March and August of 1943, while Greece was under German occupation, a total of 19 trains left the old railway station in Thessaloniki, carrying some 50,000 Jews to extermination camps, mainly to Auschwitz. After the liberation in October 1945, only about 2,000 people returned. And for this particular couple, I couldn't find out what happened. Salonika, City of Ghosts, Mark Mazaur has called the book on the city's history since the 1500s. Refugee capital is what the Greek author Yorgos Ioannou has called the city back in 1984. Salonika, City of Ghosts came out in 2004. Now, Thessaloniki increased in population and density, going, as I mentioned earlier, up to 500,000 people in 1971, doubling that by 2011. Most writers criticize the destruction of the city's social fabric, but while it is a city of ghosts, at the same time, it's very much a living city with a population that keeps growing. And even as writers bemoan the disappearance of the city of their childhood, they did not lament the disappearance of earlier communities living there. This was most likely a Muslim house in Upper Town, Annapolis. Writers record the disappearance of buildings, but only insofar as their absence is depriving them of their own childhood, their own memories. And that is what makes it hard to restore or honor a city's earlier histories. The past is set up in competition with the present. The past threatens the present, hence the violence towards the past and its memory. When I see the White Tower, I do not remember that it used to be an Ottoman prison, later whitewashed and adopted as the symbol of the city, more recently remodeled as a city museum, an excellent city museum, actually, erasing earlier associations. I remember, first of all, that it was the point that marked how far we were going to go for a walk on a Saturday or Sunday afternoon. But it was also the marker and backdrop for family photographs. Here we are seeing my paternal grandmother over here, who is also called Eleni Bastea, with her older daughter, my aunt Fofo, and her two younger kids, my brother and aunt Stasa. So the picture is probably from the 1930s. So aunt Fofo, the oldest, was actually born in Smyrna. My aunt Stasa and my father were born in Salonika. My grandmother had come from Smyrna, modern-day Izmir, a few years prior in 1921, escaping the burning city and the Asia Minor catastrophe. So I'm taking you from Salonika to Izmir. So I was born and raised in Thessaloniki. Nevertheless, it was Smyrna, modern-day Izmir, that hung in the air as I was growing up, arrested like a postcard in the time frame of our own family history. Smyrna was the city of reference in my family, though no one ever talked about going back, to the point where I now wonder if my own memories of my hometown may not be memories of Salonika or Thessaloniki at all, but rather memories of my grandmother's hometown, Smyrna, which she left when she was in her early 30s. Did my paternal grandmother ever see beyond her own city, beyond Smyrna? For the longest time, remembering Smyrna for me meant imagining the early 20th century city with its famous cosmopolitan joie de vivre. Ladies in crinolines and sun umbrellas, men in fashionable suits and hats, strolling up and down the quay. I remember, scare quotes, I remember a city that was frozen in time in 1922, when my paternal grandparents were among the thousands of refugees rushing to leave the burning city. I visited Izmir, as it's now called, a few years ago, and enjoyed its vibrant waterfront life, full of cafes and restaurants, young couples enjoying pastries and ice cream, families ordering mezes and fried fish, savoring sips of rakı. But in my mind, these were two different cities. One of them, Smyrna, residing now only in my mind, its silent history obscured by the vibrant and demanding present-day Izmir. Modern-day Izmirnyots cannot see my grandmother Smyrna any more than I can see the earlier Muslim neighborhood that lived around the Al-Aqsa Imaret Mosque, prayed there, and ordered its life around it. Are we all silencing past histories of the cities we inhabit, no matter how much we respect history and the value of architecture of the past? The sculpture here is by a French sculptor, Bruno Catalano, who actually, he and his family moved to France, I think when he was about 10 years old. And this series of sculptures were actually set up in Marseille when the city was European cultural capital, and also have appeared in other parts of the world. As I examine the connections among memory, history, and literature, I've come to believe that it's not actually memory itself, but the memory of loss that defines us as individuals and communities, shaping our sense of the past and our vision of the future. And that it's this memory of loss experienced personally through family, community, and national narratives that shape our individual, social, and national consciousness. I'm examining the notion of home across scales, from the dwelling to the neighborhood to the hometown and the nation. I'm not claiming that the loss of home is identical to the loss of country, or that its mark on an individual's identity is always mirrored on the national scale. What I'm investigating, rather, are overarching patterns and parallels, as well as distinct differences across the various scales of loss and the effects of that loss. Loss of home due to exile or migration, loss of country due to military defeat, loss of empire, starting with the migrations in the Balkans that resulted from the Treaty of Lausanne. I'm interested in the memory of loss and dislocation within larger comparative contexts that include Germany and Poland, India and Pakistan, Ireland, Northern Ireland, Israel and Palestine, Cyprus and Northern Cyprus. I have expanded the envelope of the built environment to include the loss and absence of place as determinants of our personal, social, and national identity. I believe that the concept of loss and the legacy of loss constitute key organizing principles in how we write history. The current crisis among Syrian and African refugees underscores the need to address the plight of all refugees. Tragic and heartrending as today's events have been going on for years now, it's actually the long-term effects of the loss of home and country that remain the focus of this project. And as the Israeli writer and peace activist Yuri Avneri remarked, it will never be easy to solve the problem of a man who dreams about his house and the trees of his village, even if he has never seen them. In remapping memory, the politics of time-space, Jonathan Boyerin argued for the reincorporation of space into the study of history. By considering time and space together, we can recast the study of the nation-state, still rooted in, quote, notions of fixed and unchanging geography, unquote. Edward Said insisted that, quote, if there is anything that radically distinguishes the imagination of anti-imperialism, it is the primacy of the geographical in it, unquote. And the literary historian Brian Stock concurred, quote, the hold of the past is not only legal and cultural, it is also spatial. It is expressed in land and people who are geographically placed and may think that they are divinely ordained to mirror a particular tradition, unquote. And now we'll go to Istanbul for a bit, which is the red dot on the right. Some of the same interplay among history, nostalgia, and the modern landscape is discussed in contemporary Turkish literature that focuses on Istanbul. And I should say this is about 3 years old, so it doesn't reflect what's going on in Istanbul today. So we have the book Streets of Memory, Landscape, Tolerance, and National Identity in Istanbul by Amy Mills that came out in 2010. And also another book called Nostalgia for the Modern by Ezra Ozurek in 2006. In dealing with the legacy of earlier cultures, right, I forgot to show you Istanbul. Here it is, happy trick-or-treating. Here is one of the new developments that is trying to capture a nostalgic past, a created past. So they're talking about, both authors are commenting on the legacy of earlier cultures and caution us against the siren calls of nostalgia, a mood that may often distort the past, appropriating it to the service of the dominant ideology. So we have some examples preserved sites of minorities that some of them still live in Istanbul and others not anymore, like the Church of Hagios Pantelimon here. As the architectural historian Sibel Bozdogan notes, quote, recent neoliberal post-Kemalist shifts in Turkish culture and politics have ushered in a rekindled interest in Istanbul's cosmopolitan past and in the remaining vestiges of its historical urban fabric, unquote. New developments such as, quote, the picturesque neighborhood we saw on the Asian shores of the Bosporus, widely accepted to be the paradigm of multi-ethnic coexistence, neighborliness and aesthetic charm in a city that has lost most of its qualities to Republican urban modernization is a case in point. They're cautioning us against falling in love with a past that maybe was not quite that way. Nostalgia constitutes the flip side of silence, writes Amy Mills. In Streets of Memory, she demonstrates how, quote, cosmopolitan nostalgia, along with its silences, ultimately bolsters the very same Turkish nationalist narrative that it claims to contest, unquote. I want to take you to another trip to the town of Güzelyurt in Cappadocia, and the place where my maternal grandparents came from. Following the relentless 20th century nation-building project, we all bear witness to the erasure of selective historical urban narratives and the complexity of putting history back on the map in the 21st century. I photographed this poster because I found it encouraging that it listed not only the present name of the town, Güzelyurt, but also Gelveri, which is how my grandparents referred to it, and Karbala, which is the more Hellenized view of it. Understanding the politics of memory and the unique tensions between representing the past of others on a city's canvas while forging an inclusive future will allow us to honor the surviving physical representations of the past and reincorporate their history into each city's collective memory. Now, how do states and municipalities commemorate and reintegrate the urban histories of minority or even majority populations who are not part of the contemporary city's fabric anymore? How do they educate today's residents of a city's multicultural past? Can they? Should they? Where does memory reside? The feminist writer Susan Griffin wrote in the book A Chorus of Stones, The Private Life of War, the following, and I'm quoting. I'm beginning to believe that we know everything. So this is Susan Griffin. I'm beginning to believe that we know everything, that all history, including the history of each family, is part of us, such that when we hear any secret revealed, a secret about a grandfather or an uncle, or a secret about the Battle of Dresden in 1945, our lives are made suddenly clearer to us as the unnatural heaviness of unspoken truth is dispersed. For perhaps we are like stones, our own history and the history of the world embedded in us. We hold a sorrow deep within and cannot weep until that history is sung, unquote, Susan Griffin. The anthropologist Keith Basso, in his book Wisdom Sits in Places, wrote, quote, building and sharing place worlds is not only a means of reviving former times, but also of revising them, a means of exploring not merely how things might have been, but also how just possibly they might have been different from what others supposed. For what people make of their places is closely connected to what they make of themselves as members of society and inhabitants of the earth. And while the two activities may be separable in principle, they're deeply joined in practice. So this is Keith Basso's introduction to Wisdom Sits in Places. I just want to make a comment about this inscription over a house in Cappadocia, in Giuseppe Cappadocia. The date is 1905. It's a very good stone house. It's inhabited by residents, local residents there, but it was originally part of the Greek community that left. In 1905, they didn't know that the end was coming. So after the fact, it makes you more aware of history and also makes you think of all the other people who have been displaced, their beautiful houses, the proud places being left behind or destroyed. To continue with Keith Basso's remarks, quote, if placemaking is a way of constructing the past, a venerable means of doing human history, it's also a way of constructing social traditions and in the process, personal and social identities. We are, in a sense, the place world we imagine, unquote. But what about the work of political and willful amnesia? Adrian Forty and Suzanne Kuchler, editors of the book The Art of Forgetting, point out that, quote, the relative stability of Western Europe since 1945 has in part been due to a colossal art of collective consensual forgetting of the divisions between wartime partisans and collaborators, which whatever may be said in private have in public been forgotten, unquote. As you can see, it's not only my own naivete that explains why I could not imagine the mosque in our neighborhood as it was originally used. What has also been at play is a system of forgetting the past to maintain the status quo, flawed as it may be, but stable and predictable nonetheless. Forgetting is practiced, dictated even, to save the present. This is the vindication of the present. My Turkish friend Tuna, who lived in the US for years and is now back in Istanbul, was herself born in Istanbul. Her parents and grandparents, however, came from Thessaloniki, part of the vibrant Dönme community who lived there. I'm still looking for language to describe the experience of spending a long summer afternoon with her and her parents outside of Istanbul. To them, Selanik was not only about the physical space, but about a way of life, a culture and a community that has been lost forever and cannot be recaptured. That was their own Jerusalem, their own lost land, With an intangible sense of guilt, I realized that I grew up in their city of memory. Tuna's mother cooked with recipes from Thessaloniki. She prepared lunch for us. This is about 10 years ago. She prepared lunch for us, sharing with us the recipes that her family had brought from Thessaloniki. Tuna's mother was about 2 when they were forced to leave, but the family continued the tradition. And I realized that I actually had to go to Istanbul to taste the flavors of Thessaloniki. What emerges here is the presence of several silent cities and private geographies of loss that reside in our minds, both with regards to familiar and new places. Most likely, a Turkish visitor to Thessaloniki would be interested in visiting the house of Kemal Atatürk, the founder of the Turkish Republic, who was born in this building. It's now part of the Turkish consulate. A Jewish visitor might want to visit the Jewish Museum, located in a remodeled private residence, or the site of the deportation of the Jews, now marked by a commemorative sculpture, tucked away, however, unceremoniously next to a surface parking. For most of today's residents, however, these and other similar sites are not part of their own mental map of the city, as they never entered into their own family's social memory, as I mentioned. Nevertheless, there are individuals, there are historians and some enlightened politicians, like Thessaloniki's mayor Yanis Boutaris, still the mayor, who have undertaken the preservation of the city's historical memories, even when they do not represent part of their own family history. In a few extreme cases, the underscoring of these sites and their attendant history has been followed by scorn and even vandalism. The past can be threatening to the present. The city remembers. Liberty Square, Platea Eleftherias in Thessaloniki, remembers the expulsion of the Jews. Can architecture commemorate history? Should it? And is it the job of the city and the municipality to educate? We mourn the loss of people at war and the loss of land that was once ours. But hardly ever do we acknowledge the losses suffered by enemy soldiers killed by our troops on the land we now inhabit, land that changed hands again and again and again. Do we have memorials to them? Should we? It is art and literature, then, in the tradition of Euripides' The Trojan Women, that dare address the injustice of war and the legacy of loss suffered by our enemies. I'm beginning to imagine what I'm calling an ecology of urban memory, a dynamic place where we recognize something of ourselves in a new city and a city we thought we knew. Ecology of urban memory recalls images of cultivation and minding the soil, a continuous engagement and re-engagement with memory and the present, a place where I can begin to see Smyrna and Izmir coming together, and the Jewish and Ottoman and Greek Thessaloniki also. Maybe it's the creation of third spaces, physical, cinematic, or virtual, that allow us to dream and to reflect, connect the stages of our heart. Where together, the chorus of stones and the stories of the land form an ecology of history and memory that enters a dialogue with the present and proceeds forward with full knowledge of what came before us. These are exhibits in the mosque that I started the talk with. So I'm imagining spaces where we can hear the silence between the beats of history. Thank you.
This idea that you can become, be from a city, Salonika or Thessaloniki, that has the legacy of three communities especially, but multiple communities. You can have an incredible emotional attachment, familial attachment to this place and your own sense of the history. And then as you grow, you can recognize that your historical attachment and identification of this place, in a sense, is stacked on other people's memories, and not willfully ignorant of them, but innocently ignorant of them. And there, in a sense, there's a nesting of historical memory, or a stacking and sometimes a burying. And the kind of poignancy of that recognition that we can love a place, especially a place we've left that we've become quite nostalgic about, and have, and not be honoring as much as we might wish to, the other losses that even our existence in that space required. That's a lot to absorb, really. And so I guess that when I was hearing you talk about that idea of seeing your adolescent self, you know, bopping around with your friends and taking pictures of current history to try to preserve it without recognizing that this mosque, that Muslim families had lived in the same space you were living in. That awakened in me an idea that, first of all, we're hard on ourselves. We can recognize our history and our memory denies other people's memories, but we can also create new memories that are more communal or more shared. And that is part of growing up, is looking back at our past and recognizing the pluralism and the violence and the competitiveness that may have existed in that same space. So just, you know, this, I've read some of what you've written, and I have some other responses that focus a little more on the idea of the memory of loss by immigrants and refugees in particular. But what I felt as I was hearing you talk about this idea of empty shells and recognizing that our memories are sometimes repressing and denying or ignorant of other people's memories. An idea came to me that whether it would be worthwhile to think about in terms of building a more inclusive future, not so much just recognizing the past, that we can actually rethink our memories and that we can kind of have shared, mutually acknowledging memories between different communities that may have existed in the same space at different times, or may have coexisted but not recognized each other's individual experiences. So some idea of coexisting memories, and so the notion of creating a new space in a city that honored the diversity of memory and experience is one way to do that, but maybe another is also a process of historical truth. And in my work, looking at post-conflict societies that reckon with civil war, for example, in Sierra Leone or Uganda or other countries, one of the ways that societies reckon with the past is through, you know, criminal tribunals and holding people accountable for violence and human rights abuses. But another way is through truth and reconciliation type procedures, where a big part of that is the recapturing of historical memory. And that process often involves mutually competitive stories of the past and then trying to reconcile them. And so that's, you're speaking of a space in a city that would be devoted to recognizing the ethnic cleansing that occurred at the Treaty of Lausanne when there was the expulsion of the Muslims. And
recognizing the sending of the Jewish population to Auschwitz, but also a process in which students are educated and community members come together, elderly people tell them, share their oral histories, that that's also a way of sort of reclaiming a shared historical past. So that was just some thoughts as you were speaking. And I also wanted to just tie in a little bit, starting from this theme of interdisciplinary conversations, because there's a lot in what you do that resonates with my work with looking at displacement caused by armed conflict, but then the rebuilding of societies after civil war. And so when you speak about loss of home and the memory of loss and the importance of the loss of home in your grandmother's history and in some ways even your history leaving Greece and then thinking back to Saloniki from your own memory, I find this idea of looking at the centrality of loss in the experience of refugees and immigrants in particular who are forced to leave extremely important and extremely resonant with the human rights work that I do. In my work, I'm really compelled by the mixture of loss and opportunity in the lives of survivors of war and human rights abuses who are forced to leave their homes. So, for example, the Muslims who left their city and then went to what is now Turkey. And the rebirth that can sometimes emerge from that trauma of dislocation and violence and loss of home, and the blending of harm and dislocation with healing, and the transition from the destruction of home to the reconstruction of home and place in a new land. And this vision of sort of turning harm and tearing the roots out from your past with the idea of rebirth and recreation is a bit idealistic. And that kind of idealism can be a creative force as long as it's not a denial of the suffering that people really bring with them when they are forced to leave their homeland. But if it doesn't lull us into complacency, there is a positive energy in that idea that even with the memory of loss that we bring with us, we can actually construct a new reality in a new land. And it strikes me, and this is sort of again thinking about how many of us come from different disciplines, and I'm coming from law, which tends to be very rule-based and very aspirational in some ways, and talking about rights, even though rights are so often violated and this kind of thing. But it strikes me that artists and architects have profound insights to share regarding the aftermath of crisis and displacement and violence, because you focus on building, you focus on creating. You look at old spaces, but you think about the reconstruction of new spaces. And that creative perspective, I think, is essential to survival in a new land, but also thriving in a new land and making new memories in a new place. So those are some kind of thoughts. And then I thought, because I want others to be able to ask questions, but I would pose three questions for you, which you could answer any one of. And they might be food for thought for other questions. And it's pulling you into my field a little bit, but I think there's resonance. So, one question, it sort of takes off from what I'm saying about the role of artists, is what is the role of creativity in rebuilding a life after loss in a new land? And does the creative process, poetry, literature, artisan work, or construction, you know, of places and new edifices, what is the role, can the creative process serve as an alchemy for integration of one's memories that one brings into a new place, into creating new meaning, maybe even shared meaning in a new home. That's just one idea or a question. The other is, can the memory of loss be a means of contributing to the new place? A source of activism, a source of compassion, as well as a source of sadness and alienation and maybe even marginalization. And then finally, and this goes back to this idea or question that I had about whether we could have mutually inclusive memories rather than staffed memories that mutually deny each other. For those who would welcome or exclude those who arrive, who were displaced, who were forced to leave their home. For those who would be admitting, in a way, allowing to enter those who come, bearing on their backs their memories of loss. Can our sense of home, in the place that we live in, can it evolve through these narratives of loss and perseverance that the exiles bring with them?
The last one.
So one, I guess, the first two questions are kind of those who have memory, who are displaced, mm-hmm. and who are bringing with them this uprooted identity mm-hmm. and this memory of loss. Can they turn that into an alchemy of survival and thriving,
right.
contributing mm-hmm. to the new space mm-hmm. that they're entering? And the other is the question. The other mm-hmm. side of that is for those of us who are rooted in the place that the exiles are entering, can our sense of our identity be transformed and welcoming by honoring the trauma and the loss and the history of the newcomers?
Okay.
Any of those.
Any of those, okay.
Any that resonate. Can I stay up here?
Thanks. But you can stay. So back in 2013, when I started in international studies, we had a conference, Cultures of Exile. And the point was exactly to celebrate those who came from another country, but in a privileged situation, artists, writers, and so on, and who actually started writing in the language of the host country. Mm-hmm. And my point was, and the point of the event, which was a three-day event, was to celebrate their contribution to the literature of the host country, but also what they were receiving by being, let's say, a Moroccan who works in and writes in Paris and is a product of that culture. And I think I was after the same kind of, let's not think of all exiles as victims, although, of course, not all exiles were Nabokov either. I mean, they're very privileged exiles and so on. And I think, especially in this country, Spanish-speaking artists and writers contribute to the literature is major and really does expand how we understand language. And I want to acknowledge the sense of liberation that sometimes you have when you leave your own traditional country. As a good friend of mine from China, from Hong Kong actually said, Eleni, traditions are not always good. For when I was growing up, she's in her 70s, it meant the husband will take a second wife and a third wife and so on, and maybe that's not so good for the wife. So that there is a sense maybe of reinvention that happens, but I would hate to generalize because for some people coming to being displaced also means the end of anything creative they can make and contribute, especially if their work is very connected to the place. But on the other hand, I think for many, I was trying to understand when is the first time you realize you come from a certain place. I think it's when you leave that place, and I don't mean leave as an exile, meaning leave to go visit your grandmother in another town. You know, that you say, oh, I left Salonika. Okay, so this concept of where you, who you are, very much is sharpened by the process of leaving. And maybe your identity. And I did have a student once from Colombia, the country of Colombia, who said she was doing a master's degree here. And she said, I was an Hispanic until I came here. So there is that maybe homogenization that happens. But I do see different patterns in how people discuss the places they left behind. So for pretty much all the refugees from Asia Minor who were of Greek Christian descent, the place they left was the promised land that they can never go back to. And there is even a lot of humor about how they described what they had left behind as if everybody was very wealthy and landowner of land. That is, if you added it all up, they would have left places that were maybe 10 times as large. So there is this sense to remember your past, oftentimes with rosy color, and it became a trope in the writing that what we left. And in fact, we see the same with people from Greece, Muslims who went to Turkey, and they continue longing for the place, even at the second and third generation. But it's not always the same. But I was thinking about honoring minorities and how in this particular place, and I can just speak from my own observations, and I don't want to generalize, but it is a lot easier to honor the victims. It's a lot easier, even though it's not done universally, it's a lot easier to honor the victims of the Holocaust than it is to honor the Ottomans who had occupied Greece, as we were taught in school, for four centuries. So how do you honor the victor whom you eventually pushed out? And where do you draw the line? And what of occupations and what of difficult occupations and cruel occupations? And what about civil war? So there are, I can pick and choose in a way where I see some threads, but I also realize that we accept some refugees better than others. And the island of Lesbos has set an excellent example of being very, very giving towards the refugees from Syria and Afghanistan and so on. A lot of those people were refugees originally. But this is not generalizable, yes, because that we seem to want to take care of our own, and however we define that. And it doesn't always extend, sadly. Does that answer your question? Yeah.
Yes, well, I'll maybe just really
go back and
forth. How much time do we have, actually?
We usually stop by 7. Yeah. So about 15 minutes.
Okay. It's interesting because you think about, can you hear me? Okay. You know, like you said, you can't generalize, but you can about all different parts of the world. It's dangerous to do that. And in some cases, competing narratives, historical narratives, are going to be more reconcilable than others, you know, and that's really important. But the idea that we romanticize the place we come from, and we come from a place when we leave it, I think probably in the United States, where a lot of us move, we can really relate to that. And my family's Irish and English and German and French and a bunch of things. But I grew up in a family where my father was extremely and remains extremely romantic about being Irish and Irish nationalism, even though he never lived in Ireland, and you know, but he has some heritage of that kind. And one of my sisters married an Irish man who has spent a lot of time in the United States, and he remarks on how Irish Americans have this image of Ireland, which is never existed as far as he's concerned, but certainly doesn't exist now. And so there, that can be a romanticization, but if it's worse than that, if it heroicizes one cultural experience and completely denies another, that's problematic. That's really problematic. But how about some other questions from you all, for Dr. Bastea?
Yeah.
First, thank you so much for the lecture. I wanted to know how or where one can begin to reconcile the idea that no matter how much respect they have for a place or for that place's history, that they're still walking on someone else's history. How can one rationalize that?
We're doing it here, right? So I don't know that we can avoid it. And architecture, you realize that everything we built is on contested land. It's somebody else's, and there are always fighting. So we live with it. And I think part of the difficulty of exploring one's own past is you realize not just that there were minorities that are not there anymore, actually majorities that were not there are not there anymore, but your own people were not always saints. Actually, no one's people. And I think that's also very difficult to confront. It's more difficult, actually, to confront the wrongs that your own people made, taking over land or using arson or putting people in jail or raping. I mean, all of those things that every culture does. No one is above it. So we could think of cities as palimpsests, and we could think of, and that's why I think the course of stones to me resonated, that the stones have history and they can talk, but we're also trying to be, I think, not stymied by it and to move forward and to say creating a future that's more inclusive doesn't mean that it was inclusive in the past. They were parallel existences, but they were not exchanging a lot. They were not intermarrying and so on. They were respectful. So we could move forward and go beyond that, right? And in fact, I think at the university, you do have a sort of utopia, however incomplete, imperfect, that brings the different stories together, and we have some common aims. But it's, otherwise, you can just feel totally incapable of moving, carrying all the injustices that have been done and are continuing. But yeah, maybe that's why I'm not building as an architect. I'm studying the history of buildings. Good question. Yeah. Other.
I really liked what you pointed out in terms of how there is a certain unintentional self-centeredness in history and sort of extends, you know, about back to grandparents, and people care most about what they have a personal connection to. And I certainly struggle with that as an archaeologist in terms of trying to get people to care about history that they don't have a personal connection to and trying to forge a more intimate connection. And sort of that third space that you talked about. Could you talk a little bit about how some of that can be done, or some different ways that it's been done, especially with sort of negative heritage?
So I was looking at the examples of art hanging at the outside of the mosque and inside the mosque that I showed, as well as this is some porticus and the Roman Forum that was used for photography exhibits. And somehow the experience of walking through made me feel more animated towards the original place. It brought it to life, so to speak. And I wasn't even aware of that as I was looking through. I felt, oh, this, I'm supposed to know what's going on. I'm supposed to know. So this intervention that artists can undertake with sites that sometimes are from the Roman period, who cares about that, or they can be from the Ottoman period, who cares about that, we can maybe raise awareness. But I think it is very difficult because cities in Greece that have mosques that are non-functional have been extremely reluctant to allow contemporary Muslim people to use them to pray because they're so worried about changing the identity of the city. A lot of arguments about that in Athens, which has a big refugee population that is Muslim, and even when the community can find its own sources to build a new mosque or to use another mosque, there is continuous. So I don't want to, again, romanticize, oh, there's this rosy future we're putting together. It's like, yes, we're preserving the mosque I showed you, but we're preserving it as a secular building where you can go and see exhibits by people picked by the municipality, which could be interesting exhibits, not nationalistic and so on. They can be, you know, some performance, some recording and so on. But there's a big difference between that and giving it back to its original purpose. At the same time, sometimes the same people would assume that Hagia Sophia in Constantinople and Istanbul should become a church again. So it's not, they're not using the same standards, if you know what I mean. I don't have an answer. I don't have an answer because I don't know, how far do you go? Do you commemorate do you honor the people who were sent, let's say, in the German occupation and died in Greece? I'm sure some soldiers died in Greece, but they also committed a lot of atrocities, not every single one of them, but many, and do we draw the line? So I was pushing myself to see what are the limits of humanity. Do you commemorate terrorists alongside the people they killed? Do you look at the whole society and say that, no, we don't. I mean, we will only honor our fallen, but not the people they killed in battle on the other side, usually not. There is the Gallipoli cemetery of the Australians who fought and died, and next to it is the cemetery in Turkey, in Gallipoli, of the Turks. But Armenians don't come into play. I still thought it was a move forward to have the two sides resting together, symbolically, even if we are not going in the religious realm. But still someone is left out. So I think archaeologists and historians are engaged in the same debates, aren't they?
Sometimes feel a little bit more what happens when people don't care about their non-personal histories, how damaging that can be. And so it's always a process to try to sort of spark that caring and that sort of historic compassion in people as a form of sort of protection for the, you know, historic sites, historic monuments, oral histories, things like that. But it's a challenge.
The benefit of historical tourism can convince some people to get on the bandwagon, but it hasn't been working extremely well for Thessaloniki. That is, there is a huge resistance to the efforts to acknowledge that it was a major place of culture of the Sephardic Jews and the Donme Turks. Other.
So I cut out something you said about a person actualizing they are a person of the culture they're in until they leave that place. But I also think there's another reality that I realize that if I was born here, but my parents are from Yemen, I didn't realize I was a person of Yemeni culture until I had been to Yemen. But part of my question is, how do those two cultures come into play into someone's work? Like, for example, an architect or an artist.
how would you combine those two cultures, or how would you express in terms of whatever field you're in, I guess, in an artistic field or architectural field?
I would start with dialogue. For me anyway, dialogue has been the saving grace for all of that. I'm a product of the US university system, and my experiences since I left Greece in 18, although I go back every year, my experiences have been connected to the culture of American universities. And I was able to find very many colleagues who come from Turkey who are trained there, and they were also looking for another stage in their education and came to the US. And I have found that, not uniformly, but in general, it is actually in a third place where you find people who are interested in discussing similarities and differences, and even sharing stories. Oh, my grandmother, I can't tell you how many conversations I had with people from Turkey. When I tell them I'm from Salonika or Thessaloniki, they say me too. It's like, oh, yeah, well, because their grandparents came, or it's part of the history. And I realized the point we are romanticizing that. It's not always based on history, but it's a good start. And I think it gives us some space from the nationalist rhetoric that oftentimes takes over debates in the countries themselves, because there are a lot of other issues at play, like defense and economy and so on, or refugees and immigrants. So I have found that people who, in many cases, willingly move to another country for education or growth or graduate education are also people who are seeking to make more connections. And experiencing the other, if I can say that, and then realizing that it's really the same story can be very moving. Similarly, another lecture, sometime I can talk about the fact that I interviewed people who were originally from Greece or their families and went to Turkey, and how moving that was, realizing that they are really from the country I call home. They were there at least two or three or four generations, and I was there. I mean, my father was born in Thessaloniki, but before that we had no history there. And that also, that fluidity of where do you come from becomes very, very obvious, and then maybe you're more comfortable with being like an orchid, as I think, you know, you just go from tree to tree and you blossom like orchids in the above ground, or you're like, what can I say, like a tortoise carrying your house with you. So you have all the stories in you, if you know what I mean. I have found that gestures, not only cooking, but also, I don't know, the way you prepare flowers or the way you fold the sheets and the blankets and so on, are passed down even when families have left, in my case, Cappadocia or Izmir, and moved. But I also think there are actually deep divisions within families, even if they speak the same language and follow the same faith, if they come from different parts of, in this case, Asia Minor. One of my points, and I'm not the only one making that, is it was actually the expulsion from Asia Minor that unified these people, who before would have nothing to do with each other. The people from Smyrna caring about the rural Cappadocians, no way. But once they were all displaced in a tragic way, then a certain cohesion happened. So you can have the Treaty of Lausanne to thank for a certain sense of cohesion that is a cynical approach, but it's true. Other thoughts? Yeah.
Well, first of all, thank you for inviting me to join you today. It was again a pleasure to share with you your vision of history of architecture and the cities. I also want to say that the structure of this interdisciplinary conversation is really, really appealing and interesting for me. Mm-hmm. I mean, it really forced, in a way, the conversation and dialogue between the different disciplines, something that I really, really believe in. And in these dynamics you created here, it's really visible for students and professors, so I really enjoyed being here today and seeing the structure. I may have some ideas back in Spain. You were talking about this idea of how every person or every researcher can process the idea of loss or presence of these memories through geographies and through the city and architecture, right? I really enjoyed that idea of difference and diversity in experience. Like, we cannot generalize. We are talking about this local, global sense of things, right? So talking about, you know, the experience of the different people who talk, first of all, of course, you, that you were from there, but you came here to study and then to work here. And then your experience that you are here, but your parents are from there. I'm always thinking that, as you said, the experience, no matter how long it is, of exposure to other people and to other cities and environments really change you. And in my case, in my personal case, I came to the States in the 90s to study and teach, and then I came back. And then I were there in this third space you're talking about since then, in a way, right? And coming here, again, for instance, this year, for me, it's coming home, in a way. Yeah. So I would also ask you, and for, of course, I congratulate you for this idea of loss as a positive concept and something that is really, is real for us, and we can construct architecture and cities. So my question is, in this experience of very shorter feelings or experience of places, how can we think of us as researchers and also as people, of course, in that idea of transferring that loss or possibility of finding constantly from one place to the other, in a way. It's not so ecstatic, but it's more like connecting these two spaces. Even, this is my point here, even when this experience is shorter, like saying 2 or 3 years in a place, and then you really think that you, in fact, lost something, and you have to go again and again to find that or transfer that to where you come from.
I think there are a lot of narratives of families who move from, let's say, Central Europe to Chile, in one case, I'm thinking of Marjorie Agosin, or to Israel, I'm thinking of Amos Oz, who describe in their memoirs being part of the specific culture, very much part of it, but the loss of their parents, the melancholy of their parents, also colored how they were seeing the everyday life. I'm also thinking of the writer André Aciman, who is from Alexandria originally, Alexandria, Egypt, and lives in New York. And he keeps writing about the missing Paris, that he almost does not want to go to Paris because then he won't be able to miss it, that he can write better about Paris when he's not there. And it can be a little bit maybe self-indulgent, but I don't want to underestimate the cities of the mind. Like the French book, Dreams of My Russian Summers by André Makine, where he had grown up in the Soviet Union, but his grandmother kept telling him about the French and the aristocratic life that she imagined having had and so on. And so here you can have somebody growing up in Soviet Russia, but the Soviet Union, but with this other life that was that saved him, so to speak. So it maybe many invisible cities that we're talking about, and maybe for an architect, the aim is to create spaces that people would long to come back to, right? That even with short visits, yeah. Thank you for coming.